What prevents radical change in our lives? The change that we inherently feel is necessary to bring about a new way of living. Why do we repeat the same patterns, generation after generation? Krishnamurti points out that the psychological conditioning of the past, what we have been taught by parents, peers, our education, our work, and social environment, can be iron bars that hold us. He questions our identification as members of a certain nationality, religion, or class. Can we not move beyond the old learned responses of the past? Are we condemned forever to be prisoners of the past? Krishnamurti on conditioning.
That's what I want to discuss, mm-hmm. whether it's possible to change the human condition mm-hmm. and not accept it. Say, as most philosophers, the existentialists and others say, your human nature is conditioned. You cannot change, you can modify it. Do we accept that? Or do we inquire, shall we inquire into whether it's possible to change this condition?
Yes, I think we should inquire into that.
If you say it cannot be changed, then the argument is over.
A lot of this conditioning is deep in our biological nature.
Oh, but cannot those also be transformed? I may have inherited what? Violence from the from the apes and so on and so on. Can't I change that? The inherited biological
drives,
conditioning. Yes. Surely that can be transformed.
Well, all societies surely seek to transform these biological drives that we have, and all processes of bringing children up in all societies seek to bring those drives within the control of the society.
Sir, sir.
Otherwise, you'd have complete anarchy.
Sir, why do you divide, if I may ask, society and being? As though society was something outside, which is influencing me, conditioning me. But I have my parents, grandparents, so on, past generations, have created that society. So I'm part of that society. I am society. I want to abolish this idea in discussion, this separation from me and society. I am society, I am the world. I'm the result of all these influences, conditioning, whether in the East or in the West or in South or North, it's all part of conditioning.
Yes.
So we are attacking the conditioning, not where you are born or East or West. So I'm asking, I'm conditioned that way. Is it not possible to be free of it? Free of my conditioning? If you say it's not possible, then it's finished.
You started by drawing a distinction between the brain and the mind.
Yes.
Would you elaborate?
We are saying that the brain is conditioned, at least some of it. That conditioning is brought about through experience. That conditioning is knowledge. And that conditioning is memory and experience, knowledge, memory are limited, and so thought is limited.
Yes.
Now, we have been functioning within the area of thought.
Yes.
And to discover something new, there has to be at least temporarily or for a period when thought is not in movement, when thought is in abeyance.
What is mind then?
Mind is a wholly different dimension in which has no contact with thought. Let's be clear. The brain, whatever part it is conditioned by time and thought, time thought. As long as that conditioning remains, insight is not possible. You may have occasional insight into something, but pure insight, which means comprehension of the totality of things. I would use the word totality, not wholeness, because that word is now being used so much. It is the perception of completeness. Right? That insight is not time thought. Therefore, that insight is part of that brain which is at a different is in a different dimension. Insight can only take place when there's freedom from
time and thought. It is the brain itself which listens to that statement.
Yes, it listens. And then what happens? Just a minute, what happens? If it listens, it's quiet.
It's quiet.
It isn't ruminating, it's not going on, but what does he mean? It is not rattling, it's quiet. Right?
Yes, it's quiet.
Wait. When it is actually not induced quietness, actually when it listens, and there is quietness, then there is insight. Is it possible not to be conditioned? What is the factor of being conditioned? What causes the brain to be conditioned? First of all, it's conditioned. There's the demand for security. We're not advocating insecurity. Just listen to the whole story of it. We want security, both physically, which is natural. So is there a security which is not of time, you understand? Which is not of hope? You follow? Is there a security which is not put together by desire? Right? The friend says, yes, there is this absolute security, irrevocable security. You're following this? The brain has been conditioned by attachment. There in that attachment, it sought security. To my wife, to my job, to an ideal, to some God. So, discovering that there is no security in any of that, what has happened to the brain? Please follow, watch this carefully. What has happened to your brain, which has traditionally conditioned to be attached, hoping to find security in all this, and suddenly discovers there is no security in all this? What's happened to the brain? You follow this? There has been a total change. You understand all this? As long as you cling to a particular comforting attachment, and that in that attachment you sought security, and you find now, after very careful observation, that there is no security in that, the whole movement has moved away from it. So your brain is unconditioned. Right? And that unconditioning has brought about because you saw the truth that in attachment there is no security. That the seeing that there is no security in illusion is intelligence. That intelligence, the beginning of that gives you absolute security in intelligence, not in attachment. There's been the division as the unconscious and the conscious. The unconscious is all the past, all the inheritance, all the memories of thousands of years of man. Right? Unconsciously, you may have the memories of being conditioned in Protestant, Hindu, all the rest of it. 2,000 years of Christianity and propaganda has so deeply the fear of heaven and hell, the savior, it's there deeply. And if you go to the Islamic world, it's there also, and the Hindu world and so on. So the unconscious is the movement of the past. Right? Technologically, look how much energy has gone into technology. Our brain is limited, conditioned through vast experience, knowledge, conditioned. But to discover the quality of the brain, which is not conditioned, and therefore infinite capacity, but it is conditioned now, as British, as French, as all the rest. I believe, I don't believe. I believe in God. He is my guru. That guru is better than this guru. You follow? All that nonsense is going on. So, as it is conditioned, its capacity is limited. And only when that conditioning is totally free, that means no faith, no fear, no, you follow? No attachment of any kind to anything. So, is it possible for the brain to be unconditioned? Which means, is it possible for the brain to be free of the knowing? That is, I have to know where I have to go home, which road to take, what language I speak. I have to, there is knowledge. But to be free psychologically, which is the conditioning, which the brain has been conditioned, to be free, conditioned by knowledge, to be free of that, then it has got extraordinary capacity. Then we are saying, what is the mind? When we talk of consciousness, the brain, and the mind. When the brain is completely free of that psychological knowledge, then the brain is the mind, because mind is infinite.
I'm really not an expert on the structural brain and all that kind of thing, but one can see within, one can observe one's own activity of the brain, that it is really like a computer that's been programmed and remembers. And it is conditioned.
Yes.
Conditioned by past generations, by the society, by the newspapers, by the magazines, by all the activities and pressure from the outside.
But the conditioning which determines the self, you know, which determines...
The psyche.
The psyche, or you call it the psyche.
Let's call it for the moment the psyche. The self, the psyche.
That conditioning is what you're talking about. That may not only be unnecessary, but harmful. Right?
Yes, that's what we were discussing too.
Yes.
That the emphasis on the psyche, as we are doing now, and giving importance to the self, is creating great damage in the world.
But the conditioning of the brain, as I see it, is involving with an illusion which we call the self.
That's right. Can that conditioning be dissipated?
Yes.
That's the whole question.
Yes, and it really has to be dissipated in some physical and chemical and neurophysiological sense. Right?
Yes.
But thought, the brain, it seems to me, is running on its own, from its own program, right?
Yes, and it's like a computer that's running on its own program.
Yes, now, essentially what you're asking is that the brain that should really be responding to the mind.
That it can only respond if it is free from the thought which is limited.
Now then, and we say mind, not only in reality, even brain is not divided, because we're saying that we're all not only basically similar, but really connected, right? And then we say beyond all that is mind, which has no division at all.
It is unconditioned.
Yes, which would almost seem to imply then that insofar as a person feels he is a separate being, he has very little contact with mind, right?
Absolutely, quite right. That's what we say.
He has no mind.
That's why it's very important to understand, not the mind, but my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Then whether that my conditioning, the human conditioning, can ever be dissolved. That's the real issue. Is there an action totally free from all conditioning? Conditioning is to have an ideal which then dictates or tries to impose upon what is. Right? Conditioning is environmental. Conditioning is religious. Conditioning is according to what one has read, educated, and so on. Conditioning. So the problem there is, can the mind, the brain, let's keep the word mind for the moment, can the mind be free from all conditioning so that it acts? That requires a great deal of attention. A great deal of watching. To be aware that one has ideals and is conforming our actions according to that. I am this, I should be that, which is called self-improvement. Lovely phrase. That is the self, which is selfishness, trying to improve itself, which is becoming more selfish. So, is it possible to put away all this and see actually what is and act? You understand? What is enlightenment? Who is enlightened? Enlightened of what? Enlightened about what? You follow? Surely, a mind that is enlightened is freed from all conditioning. Can a human being enlighten when he's frightened? When he's seeking power, position, accumulating money in the name of enlightenment? Enlightenment is not of time. It's not a process. It's not something you gradually come to. To be free from all condition, which also implies to be a light to oneself completely. And not depend on any person, any idea, any teacher, or light to oneself, so wholly. From that light there is action.